Let's go straight now to Divya. I was just talking about her, the code of Baijus, whom we all know. I mean, you've got to be living under a rock if you don't know what Baijus is. The premier education app, hugely successful business. And as I said, Divya's been on every single significant list of women leaders that I've been seeing in the last year, certainly. So let's welcome Divya to We the Women, the Global Town Hall. And Divya, hi. And I was just telling our audience that, you know, there'll be so much conversation. I was talking to Kareena Kapoor, who's just about to deliver her baby. And then we were talking to this great panel, which was talking about how women must keep their eye on work. And I was saying we've got Divya coming up, who's just delivered a baby and is already back at work. Isn't that right?
Yes, Barkha. I was just blessed with a baby boy a month ago, and I'm very excited to be back to work. And I just heard you say that, you know, take everything away from me, but don't take what I do every day, because I'm so passionate about what I do. I totally relate, because I was itching to get back to work. So within a week or so, I was back and full throttle right now.
Fantastic. And these are the stories we need to hear. So tell us a little bit, you know, like people who've read up about Baijus and read up about you know, but maybe a lot of other people don't know. Your interface with the app actually began as a student, and then you wanted to be a teacher. And when I say a student, I mean a student of the app. And then you wanted to be a teacher, and here you are running this, you know, business. Your net worth is at close to 4,000 crores. You're routinely sort of listed on all of these billionaire, millionaire lists. How has that changed you? How has that transformed your life? How did you get here?
I think you know, no matter how far we go, one thing which will stay core to me is the first profession with which I started. It's at Baijus itself, and it's as a teacher. And I think that's what has made me what I am today. And before a teacher, I was a student of Baiju. That's where the love for the subject actually started. And then I liked it so much that, and I realized the impact teaching could have on someone's life that I took to teaching. And I think teaching. It's slowly starting to get celebrated today, because I think all the focus on online learning is back, and people have realized, especially during the pandemic, that teaching is a very important profession. Parents are involved in their child's learning, but that wasn't the same back then. I don't think we had so many of the brightest minds in the country come back to teaching, and which is actually one of the most important professions. If you look at it creates the leaders of tomorrow. It's setting someone's future in the right gear. It's as important as medicine is, because that is what today, and education is for tomorrow. So I started out as a teacher, and when you're a part of a startup, you end up doing multiple things. Not just me, the entire team, the core team, we dabbled across functions. And I think the most beautiful thing is that all of us who were there when we started up are there even today. So we have our values completely grounded. We are the same set of people who started Baijus. It was called Baijus Classes, and today it's Baijus, the learning app. But I think since it's the same team, you know, we are all like how we were, friends, family, together like we were before. So nothing really has changed in terms of how we value the profession we are, how we value you know, the business we are in, because we did something out of passion. And I think when you do something that you love so much, it automatically becomes a business. And when you do something that you love, it becomes a business that creates an impact in someone's life. So I think that's roughly how the journey has been.
Yeah, how does it work to also be married to the person that you work with and run the company with? Because, you know, I'm asking you this because I'm imagine so it could be both ways, right? Like one, it's like you really get each other and it works well. The other is it's double the number of fights.
So I think, you know, this whole notion of opposites attract is a very real, REEL life, you know, imagination. But I think in real life, it really helps to have people on your side with similar ideologies. It works both in workplace as well as at home. So we're very similar-minded people, and our focus is basically on two things. One, and now I should say our two sons, and on the other side is the company. So we're very aligned on our mission. We enjoy doing everything together, and very similar-minded people. So I think that really works. And I mean, it's never about a fight. You can have a difference of opinion. So it's not just at home. Even when you're in an organization, and you know, and diversity in an organization brings about a lot of different opinions. But then I think a good core team which works together like a family, although they have different opinions, finally when a decision is arrived at, they all stick to it, and everybody works towards that. And that's very, very important in a company, to work without ego.
So tell me what, you know, from the point where you started and you've spoken about how it was family and friends getting to this point, what has been the toughest thing for you? And as a young woman, you know, what are the kind of pressures you had to face to get to this point? And I don't mean today. Today you're celebrated, you're wealthy, you're successful. But when you weren't all of these things, what were people saying to you? What were the obstacles that you had to face when you would go into fundraising meetings? You know, did you find that the men spoke more than the women? Did you find that the male colleagues spoke more than you did? How did all of that play out for you?
So I think investor relations has always been, and in their interest has always been inbound, Barkha. We've been very lucky to have a very strong set of investors as partners on board with us. So, and I think, you know, maybe that's one thing that we did right from the beginning and right from the top. The diversity in the organization is maintained very well. Like, so we have a 33% representation of women on the board. We have a 50% representation of women in the top management. And that's trickled down to a 40% representation.
And when did you decide that you would actually have a percentage that is cut off on the board for women?
The beauty is we never thought that we should have a percentage. I think if you take care of it at the top, it automatically gets taken care of, because women are actually, and a lot of studies indicate that they are more likely to hire women to support them. And when that happens, and when we pull up leaders from within the organization, diversity gets taken care of. So it's never that we put a number to it. You know, it's just that it's happened because we've been cognizant of diversity since inception, and that has trickled throughout the organization.
But talk before the organization was created, you know, before there was Byju's, there was Divya. What did Divya want to be?
So I've done my undergraduate in biotechnology. I was one of the university rank holders. So the immediate option was to go abroad and pursue my graduation, post-graduation, because biotechnology was not yet, you know, in the spotlight in India by then. So I was looking to go abroad, but then by then I was a student of Byju, and he told me, why don't you just try teaching one of the classes? And I went in, and there was a group of 100 students I was put in front of, and I remember it was for getting into a good company. They're called campus recruitment tests, and the students were just 4 years younger than me. I wore a sari so that I look at least, you know, a little older than my students, and it and the feedback that I got, and I could actually feel the vibe, the energy, the kind of impact that I felt that I could create and help someone learn better, get into a job that they love, that kind of held me back. So when you know, Byju said, come stay back and then we can do this together, you know, and create an impact. See, that time, very frankly, Barkha, we are all in the news now, but the kind of research which has gone into the product which we created, it's a decade old. It's more than a decade old. The research and development has started way back, because all of us are content creators at heart. All of us are teachers at heart. We are all, you know, so for us, education is at the core of everything that we do. And so even before Byju's, what we were, we wanted to help students learn better. And that's never changed. So we've been very fixated on the mission, but we've been very flexible in the way we've executed it. So I think, so if you ask me, before Byju's, it's all of us have been teachers, all of us have been content creators, all of us have passionately believed that, look, we are out to do something that is going to impact a lot of students. Of course, we didn't expect that it'll be 75 million. Today we have 75 million kids who learn from us. Frankly, we never knew that will be the number, but that was an aspiration that we had, that, you know, we want to reach as many students as we possibly can and make them love learning.
Do you find that there's any difference between you and your husband, in this case, your work partner, in your approach to work? And I ask you this because there's a never-ending debate about whether women run companies in a different way from men. I can be persuaded either way, depending on who I'm talking to. So I'm really confused about this.
So maybe he's someone who is, if he starts on a task, you can't distract him from it, and he's completely focused. So nothing can distract him. But, you know, me being the woman that I am, if family calls, I would give it, you know, importance immediately if there is something. So maybe that, but then other than that, there is no difference. He always says, hey, you're a very good multitasker. And I say, hey, you're really, really focused in one thing that you do. So for me, I need to create artificial boundaries around myself. Otherwise it will be chaos. See, today I'm at home, but I've never been at home this long. You know, after I gave birth to my first son 7 years ago, I've never stayed at home since the lockdown. That was the first time. So I it was important for me to create artificial boundaries for myself so that I'm giving equal time, because both are important. Family is important, and even work is important. So
there's a sad picture of lovely pictures of yours on screen, but go ahead. Yeah, talking about family.
Yeah, so when I look at this, I always think, you know, parents are their child's first teacher, but both of us are equally involved in teaching Nish. Yeah, and I can strongly say that we believe in our product so much that he's going to learn only from the app. So we know that technology has made us better teachers.
What do you mean he'll learn only from the app? Like, you mean you mean these apps have made schools now replaceable and redundant?
No, I'm talking about after school. I'm talking about when the child learns on their own.
I was a bit worried for a moment. Okay, can we just bring that question for Divya back on screen?
Yeah.
A question. What are some of the challenges?
Yeah.
Sorry, complete your point and then I'll ask you your question. What are you saying, Divya?
Yeah, I was saying that schools teach you very important social skills. Playing with friends, and a lot of learning happens even in the classroom corridors and not just the classroom itself. So that can never be replaced. Yeah.
So the question for you was, what are the challenges you have faced working in the Indian market? Right there. What are some of the challenges, Divya, you faced in the Indian market?
So I think today, although it's not as big a challenge as it was before, the perception of online learning people weren't as aware of it as they are today, because today, you know, as unfortunate as the situation is, EdTech has been put in the spotlight. So one big challenge which I can talk about, especially when we started up, when our app went live, when the ads were running on TV in 2015, was that people weren't aware of how our app could actually help their children. So we basically went ahead with a kind of a trial model where people could use the application for a particular period of time for free and then upgrade to advanced level. So that's how we kind of overcame it. So that was one of the initial challenges which we faced. And I think also today it's more advanced, but the fintech options were still budding at that point of time, payment options and all of that. But today it's much more robust. And so in the Indian market, if you ask me, the most important challenge which I would talk about would be the whole perception about is it a need, is it a good to have, is it what kind of it is online learning, and what where does our app stand in terms of in a child's learning journey. And today I think it's much more prominent, it's much clearer. Parents are more aware of the benefits of online learning because they're able to see the kind of impact that technology can have to help students learn better.
So I have to ask you, I have a couple of other questions, but there's a comment here which says no digital platform can replace regular classroom learning. How do you respond to that?
Yeah, I totally agree. So if you ask me, the future of learning is never going to be 100% offline or 100% online. I see it to be blended, where you have the best of both the worlds, because there are some hard subjects like math and science, which can be taught more effectively, efficiently online. But there are other subjects like physical health education, the arts and social skills, which will remain offline.
Okay, I have to ask you, there's been so much debate about, you know, white hat and when is it too young for children to get into sort of learning these tech skills, learning coding. Two views on it. One view that says this is the new reality. This is the reality we live with. These are babies of the digital age and, you know, you can't block that out. Others who are saying that this is just, you know, you're commercializing childhood. You've seen the controversy. How do you respond to it?
I'm sorry, that was a clock going on in the background. So I think it's a personal choice. So, the question about how early can you start coding, I think it's up to the parent to decide. Because here, see, nobody can say that you have to take it right now. Some people think, you know, 6 is too young, 8 may be too young, even 10 and 12. And it's difficult to predict when a person should start learning. But, you know, this reminds me of the way we used to look at computer science before. You know, at least when I was growing up, my mom used to pack me off to these computer science classes where they used to have these workshops and then they teach you. Today, if you ask me, it helped me. Like, I know I'm technologically very savvy. I'm able to do it. But again, it's a choice, I feel. it's more than, you know, you cannot push it down anybody that this is how you, this is when and where and how you need to start learning. And today, if you look at it, even 11th and 12th grade students, they have computer science in a combination. I mean, we never knew that it will get integrated into mainstream curriculum. Now, I know there is talk of the NEP saying that coding is an important skill. It teaches you, it betters your mathematical skills and all of that. And my son is also in the coding classes. So I do see a good connection between math and coding. It improves their creative skills. But again, yeah, you know, like what I want to say is that it's completely up to the parent on when they want to start, because there is never a correct answer to that. It's more a personal opinion and a choice. And until it's, you know, until and when it's integrated in mainstream curriculum is when we can actually comment on when it should, when a child should start coding.
Were you taken aback by the storm over it? Because I didn't actually fully understand it, I have to confess. Because to me, like, why is coding so different from, as you said, computer science 20 years ago or whatever, right? Is it the commerce angle that you think bothered people? And as a business, how do you intend to respond to this controversy?
So I think, you know, any company when they're starting up, and I think the most of the controversy was about, you know, why do they have programs for 6-year-olds? Yes. You know, but it's an option. Six years is an option. I mean, they have from 6 all the way up to 13, 14. So people can start even at 13 and 14. And I think, you know, when a company grows so fast, like, it will obviously get into the spotlight, and there will be people yeah. with, you know, so many opinions. And now in today's digital day and age, any sort of comment can get amplified. So I think it's about, and but you know what, I think it's about taking feedback from that. And if there is anything which has gone wrong, you know, in terms of the communication, the marketing communication, I think it's important for companies to take that positively, work on it and grow from it. Which I think, you know, even Karan has done. So wherever there has been feedback which he could use and work on, he's taken that and then quickly even changed. And I think that's how it helps. It's very helpful for any company, if you ask me, because if you are someone who's here for the long run, none of us are here actually, you know, just we've been doing yeah. this for the past 10 years and we are here to do it for the next 10. So
as a parent, let me ask you, like, if you had to decide what your 6-year-old should enroll for, would you go for a 6-year-old to get enrolled in a coding program?
My son has been coding. So that is he has been coding since he's 6. And it's like he really likes
it. How old is he now?
Now he's 7. He just turned 7.
Okay. Okay.
So he's been coding for the like past 5-6 months. And, you know, I am part of it because it happens at home. So I happen to see how the teacher teaches. And what I've noticed is that there is a strong linkage between math and coding. It isn't that different from the kind of math that they do at school. It's very creative because they get to design their own apps. He seems to enjoy it a lot because he asks me for it week on week. But again, like I said, right, it's completely a personal choice. It can never be forced upon anyone. And there isn't a right answer to when a child should start coding. So I think that should be completely up to the parent. They should have, and this child, of course, I mean, a student can also tell the parent that, you know, hey, this is a new subject I want to learn. It's like enrolling for piano classes. Do I want to do it? Now a parent has interest in it and a child has interest in it, and then they go for it. So I think it should be completely a family's personal choice.
So I have a couple of minutes left with you, and let me take a few more questions. I saw one question that wanted to know, how does Byju's ensure inclusivity, right? So you were talking earlier about how there is 33% of women in leadership positions, whether it's on the board or in other leadership roles. That's one question. You know, how do you ensure inclusivity? Another is, and this is a super question, and it's really important for the pandemic year. Can we please bring it up? How do we make online learning accessible to those children who are less privileged? Are you taking a step towards that? Now, you know, I did some work this year traveling across India reporting the pandemic, and the digital divide has never been clearer to me. Only 11% of India actually has access to a computing device in their homes. So basically what's been happening is that poorer families are falling out of schools, right? Because there is either no device. If there is a device, there is no internet. And, you know, or they don't know how to do these classes on mobile phones. And we even saw this tragedy of this very poor family from Hyderabad, scholarship child studying in Delhi's Lady Shri Ram College. And when classes went online, she didn't have money for a laptop. She was really stressed out. Her father drove a auto, and she was like, he was an auto mechanic, I think, and he really, really worried about putting that burden, and she died by suicide, right? So this can really become tragic. So I think this is a big question for online learning. How do you make it inclusive in a country where only 11% of Indians have access to a computing device?
Yeah, so the last statistic I saw was, I think 2011 or 2015, was 70% of our students have access to a smartphone. And I also saw another one, that there is a 40% increase in internet penetration in rural India. Now, I know that there is a digital divide and there is a lot of talk about it. But, you know, in the future, with the rapid rise in the access to internet and cheaper options available, you know, I think we just need to think whether it's easier to build schools and provide access to good teachers everywhere, or actually, you know, in the long run, ensure accessibility to internet to poorer regions. And there are enough ways to do it, not just with internet, even without internet, it can be loaded on smartphones. And I think there is so much space for companies, edtech companies, to come up and create that kind of difference, to come and then create solutions for, you know, poorer India to access. We are working towards it. We have a couple, it's a little early for me to, you know, disclose anything right now, but we're also cognizant of the fact that there are, unfortunately, so many students who are missing out. But in the long run, I think, you know, there is a lot of talk about digital divide, but, you know, in the future, I feel that is one way which can, having a digital divide today is something which is going to lessen in the future because of the rapid rise in internet penetration, if the numbers I've seen are right.
I'm hoping that you guys are doing something to reduce this divide, and I look forward to watching that space more closely. Final question, your message for young girls everywhere. You're a biotech student. You're now a co-founder of a you know, online learning tech app. What would you be saying to girls everywhere?
What I would say to them is, one, I think follow your dream, because no matter what 10, 20 people may tell you that what you're doing is not right, but if you believe in what you're going to do, please go out and do it 100%. Two, I would say, please try, especially if you have been gifted with a good education, please make use of it, because the statistics are so dismal. Half the women leave the workforce around my age, and just a quarter of them come back after maternity leave, and another half of them go back. You know, they leave the job. So if they can actually get themselves to come and work, it's going to create a huge impact. And here I want to say that there are so many opportunities for women to work. And I'll take the example of White Hat, because they've created job opportunities for 10,000 women teachers. Their team is completely women. So there are enough and more roles available for them to do from home, to execute from home. There are a lot of opportunities coming up. The golden age of teaching is coming back. So there are opportunities for women everywhere if they really want to do it. But of course, I think the support from family is very, very important. Mentorship at home is really important. So message is not just to women, but also to the families of these women, to support girls in going forward and pursuing their career.
One question on our stream is an important one about rolling out in local languages, considering that only a minuscule percentage of India actually studies in English or processes content in English. And, you know, online learning is changing that also. There's a more informal understanding of languages also, but people do still think and dream in their local languages. So any plans on that from Byju's?
In fact, we do have our app in all or most major Indian languages. And, you know, including Hindi and most of the major languages, it's already available on the app. And we did that because we were cognizant of the fact that students in Tier 2 and Tier 3 cities are also benefiting from the app. In fact, more than 65% of our students come from outside the metro. So that is something that is already available on the application, because we do understand that children will understand better if they're learning in their mother tongue. And they also have an option to learn in English as well.
So, Divya, you started by saying that you're thrilled to get back to work. And, you know, we were talking with the previous panel about the importance of women being economically self-reliant. And today you're worth more, you know, than I can count the zeros in that worth. But when you earned your first significant salary, do you remember that day and what it meant to you?
Yes, I do. And I think the first thing I did was I bought a sari for my mother. And I bought, a shirt for my dad, because my mom has been a big mentor to me. Of course, today I realized that, you know, I'm the only child. And today I realized the importance of that, because, she's been working in Doordarshan. She's been a government servant. My father's been in the armed forces. He's been a doctor serving the Indian Air Force. So I think, you know, and I was the only child, so no siblings to spend time with. But my mother, even though she was so successful professionally, made out time for me. So I think indirectly in the back of my mind, I've always felt, you know, I should work and I'll be able to do it. And even today she helps out, because I don't think I'll be even able to talk to you if she was not taking care of the grandchildren. So I think having those kind of that kind of mentorship and support is very, very important.
And how has your life changed going from being a middle class girl to this wealthy icon? How has it changed you?
I don't think anything has changed for me, because what makes me happy before makes me happy now. And I think what made me happy before was being with my family. I always wanted my dad and my mom to be near me, which is one big reason why I didn't go abroad to pursue my my higher education. And today I fought with them and I made them come and stay very close to me. So I think, you know, these are the small joys which will never change no matter what happens to you financially. So.
All right. Brilliant. A lovely story. Lovely, authentic details there. And glad you're back at work. Congratulations on being a parent, but glad you're back at work. I think that's the important message that needs to go out to young women everywhere and to workplaces. And look forward to what Byju's does next. Divya Gokulnath, the co-founder of Byju's on We the Women, the Global Town Hall. Thank you so much, Divya, and we'll be in touch. Thank you and take care.